Thank you for all attending my talk. This talk is about, I just finished my master's in computer science and my dissertation topic was implementing or extending the Go library, the network library, with the HTTP protocol. So this is what this talk is about. Short introduction. I live in London. I studied part-time at the Birkbeck University. And I've been working for broadcasting most of my working life. And at the moment, I'm working for a company who builds games for children. So why FreeBSD? So first, actually, a question. Who is familiar with the HTTP protocol? OK, a little bit more about the HTTP protocol. It's a transport layer protocol in the same layer as TCP and UDP. And it's 10 years old now, and it's starting to get some traction in specific industries. I will explain a little bit more later. Go, who is familiar with Go? Not that many. Okay. So Go is the new computer language invented, created by people in Google. Most notably, Ken Thompson and Rob Pike are the main contributors to this language. So, okay, so why FreeBSD? First of all, Go runs on FreeBSD, so that's a good thing. And the reference implementation of HTTP is mainly done on FreeBSD. It's also done mainly on Mac OS X. And the demo we'll give at the end of this talk will be on OS X. So first, I will give an overview of HTTP and Go, so everybody can get familiar what it actually is. Okay, so the first thing with HTTP, well, it's a connection protocol. And it's quite similar to TCP, in that you can open a socket, you can open a connection, like with client and server. But it's also very similar to UDP, where you can actually just send a message to a server and that will open a connection for you. In HTTP, you don't really talk about like a socket. You have sockets, but if you talk about connections and connecting from a server to a client or from a client to a server, you talk actually about associations. So what is an association? Is it visible? Not really. Okay. So let's say this is the server, and this is a client. The first thing you will notice if you create an HTTP application is that you within a single connection, you have this concept of streams. So what does this mean? So within HTTP, you can actually send a specific data. Oh, yeah, all the data is message bound, like UDP. But you can send it over a specific stream. So if one stream of data loses some of the packages, lots of stuff get resent, like you have in TCP. And that problem is called the head of line blocking. So with HTTP, you can have like multiple data streams. And if your data is not related to each other, you send it over different streams, and it will not block each other. So that's one of the concepts of HTTP. Another thing which you will see immediately is that within one HTTP association, you can have multiple network routes. This was actually mainly done because of a request from the telephone industry, who was not really happy with the failover capability of TCP. That was 10 years ago, but another nice thing about HTTP, or what I think is nice, is that just like UDP, you can have a single server with a single association of listening on a single association, and multiple clients can connect to it. So that's a very short overview of what it is. So I already mentioned this. It's not a byte stream protocol. It's in HTTP, you have message boundaries, just the same like in UDP. Another thing which is, I think worth mentioning is how the connection is set up. If you compare it with TCP, you get a sync and acknowledge, and at the red dot, resources get allocated. In SCTP, you first initialize, then you get an acknowledge, where the server will send some information. The client has to resend that and say, I'm really who I say I am, and then the resources get allocated, and then the acknowledge gets sent back. This mechanism prevents syn-flood attacks. So a quick comparison with TCP, because they're very similar. If you look at the TCP socket API, you see over here, socket, bind, listen, accept, receive, send, close. This for the server side. And if you look at the SCTP side, you see socket, bind, listen, and then receive message, send message, and close. The thing you notice is that setting up a connection in SCTP is implicit. So you don't have to worry about that. The other thing you notice is that SCTP makes use of receive message and send message. These are quite old system calls. I think they were introduced in BSD, in one of the first ones. And receive and send message were designed to actually send messages together with ancillary data, like metadata about what you're sending, to the other side. And SCTP actually makes use of that mechanism to send SCTP-specific information via these system calls. Okay, now bird's eye view from Go. This is going to be like a really brief overview of what is possible in Go, but I only will talk about the things which are relevant for this talk. So the first thing you see if you have variables is the first thing you will see if it kind of has a C syntax, Go, but the first thing you always will immediately will notice is that the type is after the name. That's one of the things. Another thing is that Go has pointers, but it doesn't do pointer arithmetic, just to keep it simple. But keeping it simple is actually one of the design philosophies of the Go design team. And then you have various ways to create your variables, initialize it. If you don't say anything, it always gets initialized to zero, so you don't have to think about it. And if you want a specific value, you can say it like that. So let's have a look at the function. One of the things with Go is that, well, it's a normal function. The type comes after the name, as I said before. But the other thing is this part, is that functions in Go can have multiple return types. So what you see here, so for example, if the count equals zero, oh, this should be a double equal sign, anyway. Then you can say, you can send an error back, or otherwise a greeting, and then the error will be nil. So if you have this function, you can call this function like this. So greeting, and then the error, so the two variables, and they get initialized and created via this symbol, and then you can see, you can check for the error, and or you can just print the greeting. If you're not interested in the error, because you know that will always go correctly, you can ignore it with an underscore. So in Go, you can also have structures where you have a type, struct, and you put some variables in there. Very straightforward. If you want to add a method to your structure. You don't define it within your structure itself, but outside, you actually say something like this. You say, I have a function which is called say hello, and I want to add that to my person structure, the one I just mentioned before, and the input of this method is a string. So Go also has interfaces. This is an extremely simple implementation where we have an animal interface. We have a cat object, doesn't have anything in it. And we add the implementation of the talk method is here. You can see the talk method is added to a cat object. And then we have a small program over here which actually initializes a cat object. Then the cat object talks. And in this one, we create a variable of animal type with the cat object, which actually then gets cast to an animal object. And this is like an animal object which talks then again. So there is much more with the Go language. The things I'm actually not mentioning is Go routines and channels, which is a mechanism to do concurrency. Concurrency is actually a primitive built into the language itself. It's a bit like Erlang. The other thing I didn't mention is that Go has closures. And another interesting thing which is worth looking at is slices. People say it's really nicely implemented. On the Go website itself, there's like an interactive tutorial. Takes 15 minutes to go through, and then you have a very good idea what the language can do. Okay, so now a little bit about the Go network library, because the problem I stated in my dissertation is, if I have the SCTP protocol, how well will it fit into the existing Go network library? And because conceptually SCTP is quite different from TCP and UDP, but it's also quite similar. So this research was actually to find out if it was possible to actually use the existing library and extend it instead of creating a whole new library. So what I'm first going to do is first going to show you a very typical a client which just sends a message with TCP. Well, I hope people can read this. This is like package import for the net library. And then we have a function main. And in here, you see we do a dial with the TCP protocol to localhost. This is the client. Eh? This returns an error and a connection object. So if the error is nil, then, oh, this is another nice feature in Go, is that we can actually already say beforehand that we want to close the connection if it is not needed anymore. This is very useful if you have multiple exit points in your function. You only have to state the close once. You can do it with all sorts, with all different functions or methods. Okay, so that's the close statement. And then if the message is received, if we have the connection, we write a message to it, which is like a byte array in hello world. So this is the most typical client you can do. So all the other protocols in the Go network library, like Unix sockets, UDP, that's it actually, and TCP, all use the same mechanism as dial for the client side. So now a quick look how a server would catch this message. So what we see over here is first we create a listen. We do a listen, which will create a listen object. The listen actually does the creation of the socket, the binding to it, and the listen all in once. So the three system calls are actually wrapped in this one. We check for an error, we create a buffer to hold message, and then we have like an endless loop where we do an accept for an incoming connection. Once the connection is there, we read from the buffer and we print it out, and then we start again. So very straightforward, not that much code. Personally, I think it's very readable if you compare it with C. So I quite like that. So the next part of this talk is about extending the Go networking library with HTTP. So if we then look how a server should look like, we have what we previously saw, the net.listen, which actually is implementing the listen interface in the Go network library. And the listen interface is an interface for stream-oriented protocols. So there is also a listen packet interface, which is meant for message-based protocols, like UDP, and in this case, HTTP. So what I did, I took that interface, the listen connection of the listen packet interface, and started implementing all the HTTP methods. So a typical client should look like this: listen packets with HTTP protocol, start to listen on localhost. Also the same, defer close connection. And there we make a byte array, and then we read from and then print it out. Yeah. So you can already see that it actually is extremely, it's kind of the same. It uses the same mechanism as any other protocol in Go would do. If we want to use more specific HTTP functionality, for example, we want to know what the stream ID is, so you know which stream the data is coming from, or you want to look at the association ID, so you know where it actually is coming from, then you can do a more specific call, which I added to the HTTP connection object, and which then does a read from HTTP. And then it's kind of an extension to read from. But if you look at the return values, you have much more specific HTTP information coming back. So for example, the SID is then the stream ID, and the AID is then the association ID. So if you are interested in that, you use a more specific call. So a typical server, which is more HTTP specific and makes use more of the HTTP functionality itself, would look like this. First, we need to have like an HTTP address object, which we create with this. Then we create a connection object, and this connection object is not just a packet connection object, it is an HTTP connection object. Then we say listen to HTTP, to be more specific, we say to the HTTP protocol, and then we say, we give it the address thing. Okay, defer close, and then we go into the for loop, buffer for the message, and here you see the HTTP specific method, read from HTTP. And in this case, I'm only interested in the stream ID, which I then print out together with the message. So now, I will explain how I implemented it, and I will only look at the server itself because of time constraints. So we'll talk from where the system calls and then all the way up. So if you look into Go itself and in the source code, if you go all the way down and then you look where how Go actually accesses the system calls, you will at certain point you will see some assembly code. And this is actually the layer between the Go language and the kernel. So these are kind of very generic system calls where you can actually say, this is the system call number I have, and this these are the parameters I want to pass to this system call, and then you get a return. So, of course, not everything is written in assembly. If you then look a bit further into the Go library, and specifically in the syscall library, you see a whole host of Perl scripts. These Perl scripts are actually used to generate code, which can actually access the system calls via the assembly code I just showed. If you start adding, what I did was actually these Perl scripts, they look at header files, and in case of FreeBSD to the master syscall file, or is it syscall master, to actually generate the system calls and the corresponding codes. So what I did was actually adding the SCTP header files and pointing to the right direction. I had to upgrade my FreeBSD kernel to the latest version to be compatible with the latest SCTP API, which actually changed 6 months ago quite dramatically. And then it started generating loads of these code system calls. So what I also need to do is adding the structures for ancillary data, which send message and receive message needs specific for SCTP, is kind of done in the same way. There are also specific Perl scripts. You have to point them to the right direction. You have to hand code a little bit here and there, and then you get all the information you need to have like a low level access to the kernel. So it would have been better if this was like kind of a sequence diagram, but if you look at this, you see syscall. This is actually the syscall towards the assembly code I showed you. And then on top of that, you do a syscall listen. That's kind of a wrapper around the nicely generated, auto-generated code, which is not very nicely, doesn't really nicely fit into the Go philosophy. It actually works with unsafe pointers and not with Go pointers, so you have to do some casting around. Then, on top of that, you do like an internet socket call. And then there are some, these are the other system calls which are done. I've put them to the side. And on top of that, you see the listen SCTP, which I showed you in the other example. And above that is then the listen packet. So from an application developer perspective, you can start using the top one or that one. And all these underneath it, you can also use if you want to do really specific things. I think that's one of the nice things with Go and how the network library is designed, that if you're not really interested in the nitty-gritty details of a specific protocol, you can just go use the really simple method. But if you want to go really specific, you can go deeper and deeper and deeper. So this is then the same, but then after the listen you had to read from, where you have the system call to the receive message. You see the sys receive message is the number which corresponds, I think, with the master syscall number in FreeBSD, and then it goes all the way up in a more and more nicer wrapper around it and easier to use. Okay, so now I'm going to do a small demo session. I have to say, all this code is available on my Bitbucket account. So that I've got a Go SCTP thing, which can be cloned. And this will work on Mac OS X and FreeBSD. And it must be the latest version of FreeBSD, otherwise the system calls are not correct. Okay, the nice thing with Go is that you can do the compilation and execution in one step by saying go run. So, okay. The part of the demo. So, and the first thing you see over here is that the dial, it says the protocol is not supported because this is intentionally. Hello. We put it there. Okay. So yeah, so this is intentionally because I didn't load the drive. Eh? I think it is like, oh. I've already compiled the driver, so now I'm loading. So we, and now we do the run of the server. So the server is running now. It's actually almost the same as in the example. There's only one difference. This is actually listening for a message, and if it gets the message, it returns it as an echo to the client. So we've got a server running over here now. So we go here. So we do, this is in a small, actually I can show the code maybe. What is it? It's a bit more code than in the, on the slides. What you see over here is, you see, is it readable? Kind of. Well, it's a function where I send a message. Oh. Yeah, I send a message every 1 second and then wait for the message. You can see the write to and then the read from, and then there is like a for loop going on there. So let's run this one, echo client. And if we look at the server, we see the server over here receiving that message. Well, actually, I want to do it slightly different because I want to say this message is first. And there you see the first message is being received by the server. And now, to demonstrate the association kind of thing, we're going to start a second client with message seconds. And let's have a look what the server says. And the server is receiving both messages. So the server is actually just listening on one socket, which is an association, and is receiving now messages from two different clients. So, so this implementation I've done so far is actually a very basic implementation. This is the kind of the minimal implementation needed to actually make HTTP work in Go. I'm actually having plans for future work. One of the things I want to do is that HTTP is not available on all platforms, so it's not natively available, for example, on Windows and other BSD things. I don't know, actually, quite true. But there are implementations of HTTP running in user land on top of UDP. So one of the things I want to do in the next step is actually implementing HTTP on top of UDP in Go, and then the wherever you, whatever platform you're using, you can always use the HTTP protocol in that way. Another thing which I want to do is that Go has this, the Go routines, which have channels, and these channels communicate with lightweight functions. It's actually kind of the Erlang model of concurrency, where messages get passed from background process to another one. And there used to be a library in Go called the NetGen library, where these channels could run over a network. But that's before the version of one of Go, that library got pulled because Rob Pike was not happy with the implementation. Now, I'm not sure because I have to actually implement it and build it and prove it, is that the concept of streams could easily be matched conceptually to net channels. So one stream could be one net channel. And I'm thinking of actually building an alternative for this NetGen library so that Go routines can start talking over a network. So that's actually the future of the what I want to do with my research. So if people are interested in my work, here are my WordPress, Twitter. On the Bitbucket, I'm using, because the Go official Go repository is using Mercurial, which is supported by Bitbucket. So my implementation is on Bitbucket. I try to keep up to date with the latest changes of the official Go repository. And on my normal GitHub account, there's all the implementations I did for my dissertation. All the examples you saw in these slides and more bigger examples are available on my GitHub account. If you have any questions and you want to try it out, you can always email me, and this is my website. Okay, so far this presentation. Are there any questions?
Have you passed any of this back to the folks at Google?
Not yet. I handed in my dissertation 3 weeks ago, and I finished the paper for an IEEE conference. But I will send an email to them.
Because I think they would be interested in this sort of thing.
Yeah, I definitely hope so, actually, yeah.
I was just wondering, you were using receive message, right?
Interface. Yes, that's correct.
That's the normal receive message syscall, right?
Yeah, that's correct.
I was wondering, how do you distinguish different flows in these streams? In the how do you distinguish them from different sessions?
So, if you have the receive message, there is this message header. Actually, no. What you see in that, you have this message header structure in the receive message. And this message header structure, you can also add an IOVAC structure. And this IOVAC structure is then used to put an SCTP structure in there, which contains all the information to distinguish between associations and kind of and other things. Yep. Any other questions? No? Okay, thank you very much.